rises across a blood red sky, moving in from the east towards the west, with battle-clad helmets over the heat. Yes. Do you think that Jesus Christ is coming?
And we have the honor to receive us our guest, Mr. David Duke. Welcome back in Europe, I would say, because at least according to my reading of your book, you first lived in the same town where I live now, in Den Haag, The Hague, after you were 5 years old, I guess.
That's correct.
And then you had to go back to the New Orleans.
Yes.
Well, the point is that we are about the same age, and I would like to compare a little bit our lives, because there are many similarities, and there are also some contradictions. When you came back to New Orleans, maybe you can a little bit picture what was going on. There was a civil movement. There was, you were awakening already at school because your teacher told you, hey, this this theme that you chose, that is integrated school, you should do the negative of that. So you had to look for material who is supporting segregated schools, and then you could not find material. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I have to say first that it's important that your viewers understand where I came from. I was in Denmark, and I went to a Dutch kindergarten.
Yes.
And in Holland at that time, much more so than today, it was a very idyllic life. There was very little crime. People rode their bicycles everywhere. There was it was a very homogeneous society.
Exactly. You haven't been back
in the early 50s. I haven't been back to The Hague. I've been back to Amsterdam and a couple of places.
Well.
But not there specifically. I'd like to go back to the same street I lived on. But it was a very idyllic situation. And I can still remember the bread man that came by and the milk wagon that came by. And I remember how it was in school. Again, it was completely homogeneous, and it was a very wonderful, kind place. I've been to Holland since, and obviously there's some big changes that have come about. And unfortunately, I would think not for the best, in terms of higher crime rates and more property damage, more violence, a lot of disunity, a lot of very difficult situations. When I came back to America, it was still pretty idyllic as well for a while. The schools in New Orleans were segregated, that is, they had white schools and they had black schools. And actually, the racial relations were quite good. Even though we had the presence of minorities, we had a separate society, and the relations between the races were good. I would often go down to the black districts. My family had a lady named Pinky who was a housekeeper in my house, and she often took care of me, and she was quite a fine, very nice black lady. And we would often go and take her home to the middle of a black neighborhood with no fear of violence. There was another black neighborhood near where I lived where I could walk without any problem. But over the next few years, all that changed. There was forced integration of education, and there became to be a lot of problems. Now, what I read in the media was that integration of schools and mixing of the races was going to be a good thing. That it was going to bring us peace and love and brotherhood and progress, and it was going to help the black situation out. They were going to raise their income. It was going to lessen their family problems, lessen the violence that did exist in the black community. And as a young person, I certainly wanted to believe this. It was the kind thing to believe. It was a good thing to believe.
In order to say fast a little bit the interview, there are some similarities in our place. Maybe 10-20 years later, we had this massive immigration, not so much of black people, but people from Muslim countries. And then we have been overwhelmed by them suddenly, and overwhelmed by crime rates of their size. And then if we like to criticize that, we were, running against the wall. It was, in fact, that what I think was your experience there as well.
Well, criticism, I think, in Holland as in the United States was just not permitted. The major media did not permit any criticism. It just basically was a one note. And the one note was the blessings of multiculturalism, and how this was going to be a good thing for America, how this was going to be a good thing for Holland. And there was no dissent really allowed. And if someone did try to dissent from this issue, he was demonized.
Yes, as what?
As a racist.
Exactly. And by whom?
By the media.
And who did run the media?
And the government.
Now, that is a very striking similarity. Because when I was criticizing this multiculturalism for downsizing our ethnicity and so on, it was the Anne Frank Foundation, and in your case, I think the Anti-Defamation League, who were so vociferous about us, telling that we were the racists and the extremists and the ultra-rightists and whatever.
Right.
And so then they now are even demonstrating for less Islam in Amsterdam, although they have been vilifying us for so long.
Yes.
So that is a little bit
It's very similar, very similar pattern. And this isn't, it's very important that we have to say this these days, not only for justifiable reasons and for human rights reasons, but also in terms of the legality, that we're not talking about every Jew. We're not saying that all Jews tried to destroy European racial demographics at the same time support Israel, but certainly a significant percentage. Israel, no doubt about it, is a racial state. It's an extremist state. It's a state based on the preservation of the Jewish people. They have strict immigration laws, always have, and they have strict segregation between Jews and non-Jews in Israel, separate schools. They even take even the settlements that have been stolen from the Palestinian people are segregated. They don't even, many of them don't even allow Palestinians on the land.
So in other words, these organizations, they preach something different to us that they would like to be applied in Israel.
In English, we have a word for it. It's called apocrisy.
Yes.
It's when you advocate one thing for other people than what you advocate for yourself.
And then you had some phenomena which are also very similar, like affirmative action, right. And this the entire idea that you can integrate people, but only within their own quarters, and all that became a failure.
Yeah, affirmative action is just a nice word, what we call a euphemism in English. It's a nice word for racism against white people. It's about racial discrimination. It's saying that if a white person is better qualified, he shouldn't get the job or the promotion. Yeah. Even if he's better, he should give his position to a member of a non-white.
We have been also that. Now, I have, so far the similarities. But now I have a question about some development in your brains, okay, which is completely different from mine.
Yes.
Because, in a way, you have to explain me why you became such a profound anti-communist. I will explain you why I ask this question.
All right.
I've been in 1972 to Moscow, yes, which was a very well-organized place for my type of people.
Yes.
Only not on the 1st of May, then all the Asian people came there. Huh? Mm-hmm. And I've been in 1979 to New Orleans, mm-hmm, which was quite frightening already at the time.
Yes.
So my idea was, no, if I have to choose, the Eastern Europe side is much better. And I also thought how can they solve that in America? This is going out of hand. Not knowing that we will have the same problems 20 years later in our place.
Right.
But seeing, I saw this influence of some Zionistic organizations in America.
Yes.
I didn't see that so much in the Soviet Union.
Correct.
So I thought, why did you become an anti-communist?
Okay, well, I can explain that to you. From a dichotomy. It was actually from a misunderstanding Americans had about the development and what communism had transformed into in the 1960s and 70s and 80s, after the war, after the period of Stalin and the Second World War. It kind of comes from this. The communists in the United States of America, the communist movements, the communist leadership, in America in the 1950s, 60s, like the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, was overwhelmingly Jewish extremists. Overwhelmingly. Chicago 7 activists in Chicago, Jerry Rubin, Abby Hoffman. We can go on and on. We can talk about the Communist Party itself. The Communist Party actually shared the same office in New York as the largest Yiddish newspaper.
So that was the American Assembly.
Yeah. Exactly. And the communists were very much strongly in favor of open immigration in the United States of America, these Jewish communists. They're extremely in favor of forced immigration. And so we didn't quite understand that even though communism outside of Russia was this way, we didn't understand that Russia itself had a transformation from a communist type of system to a more nationalist system.
Exactly.
And we finally did realize that by the 1970s and 80s, I began to realize that, and as many other Americans, perceptive Americans, began to realize that Russia underwent a transformation. And that's one reason why there was so much subversion of the West against Russia in the 1980s, because they had really lost the Jewish extremists, the pro-Zionists, had really lost the power in Russia that they once held.
Yeah. Then we are in the 70s, and there are two phenomena I also like to know what happened in your brains. There was the Vietnam War.
Yes.
For me, it was the first war on the television. They did not really censor it too much.
Yes.
And I thought, so that's the evidence. They are barbarians. These Vietnamese, what did they do wrong? They were not Jewish or whatever. But why? Your book, I don't read any word about it. Also,
you don't have any words of criticism of the communists in North
America? No, of the American war against the Vietnamese.
Consideration. Well, okay, I didn't go into that particular aspect. I talked about what I was doing there in supporting the anti-communists.
Yeah.
We were anti-communists at the time. And again, the communist movement in America was pushing for open immigration, open borders, destruction of American traditions, destruction of our traditions and values.
Yes.
We saw it, and by the way, we saw it in Eastern Europe as well, and we saw it in Russia, destruction of all the old churches. And we saw that. And it was portrayed to the American people as as a domino effect, that as the communists developed more and more parts of the world. Now, today, we can look back at it and say, you know, it was really, Vietnam was, there was never any true American interest being in Vietnam. And I believe that, and I've said that since that time. We can say that then, but we were talking about the development of my life, so what I was talking about then was that period of my life, in my viewpoint. I didn't go later into the process of discussing that, but I'm going to discuss that now with you or anybody else anytime.
Then it is in the 60s, in 68, for instance, there is this, what we now know, the influence of the Frankfurter Schule and of the sexuality of Mr. Boas and the psychology of Mr. Freud, really meant to attack Western societies, to dissolve them a little bit. I should say, I didn't know that at the time. I did enjoy very much this time.
Of course.
But then there's another difference. That's what I think. You became the more and more very, or was at home already, very Christian in a way. And we became much more secular in a way.
Well, one of the responses that the American people had to communism, and it happened to a degree in Europe in some quarters, like in France it's happened to a lot, was to respond to communism with more of a more modern Christianism. The traditions of the Christian church, faith, art, you know, all that, as an opposition, as an ideological opposition to communism. And there are still many people like Patrick Buchanan, who's a perfect example of that, who sees the church as a bulwark against this one worldism, this globalism, this Jewish extremism.
But I only mention it because, for instance, in the GDR, communist Germany, family life was.
That's great.
The youth centers were number one. They had many problems they did not have. No drugs, no cultural minorities. They were very
And it shows you sometimes the power of an ethnic group and the traditions.
Exactly.
The Germans, under the theory of socialism, communism, there was no country that did better than the Germans did. And in terms of the theory of capitalism, there's no country that's done better economically than the Germans did. There's something, the Germans have a great deal of organization, they have a great deal of heritage and tradition, which really kind of makes them excel at any sort of government reform. And I agree with you. I think that, you know, there were some things I don't like about the, obviously about the GDR. There's a great deal of repression. People were put in prison for their ideas. I believe in freedom of speech and thought and press. And I
Do you have it in the United States?
We have it in some ways, yes. We have it more than Europe in some capacities.
Certainly.
We don't get thrown in jail for criticizing Jewish extremism. You know, you can criticize Muslim extremism or you can criticize whatever, white extremism, even black extremism, but you can't criticize Jewish extremism in Europe.
Except
they could put you in prison. In America, you can basically not go, you don't basically are thrown in jail under criminal hate statutes. But they have ways to restrict you politically and to act against you, maybe through under the table. I was prosecuted for tax.
I see. I have my professional ban as well.
Yeah.
But you just referred to Mr. Buchanan.
Yep.
Well, I did read his book, that is the death of the West.
Yes.
And with alarming figures about the dearth of birds in. Among European peoples, because I think before the year of 2050, another 30 million Germans will, say, disappear. The same picture in Russia. Also, I think even in the United States, it's predicted that this European people of European descent will be minority.
Yes.
So we are, in a way, disappearing. It's quite alarming.
We are.
And like in the words of Mr. Stalin, quantities have a quality of its own. So there might be a certain tip over where you then, according to this mathematics of demography, will suddenly disappear in a way. And that is, I think, our common problem.
That's correct. I mean, we're literally in a crisis of existence. I mean, the decisions are being made now and things are taking place which will decide whether or not our people continue to exist as a people with our identifiable characteristics or values, the same culture that we have, the same heritage, even the way we look, even the aesthetic values of Europe. And I see this to be a tragedy. As we were talking about last evening, you know, we see many people in Europe who are concerned about Tibet.
Yeah,
save Tibet.
Think of someone else.
Save Tibet. And the you know, and the principles of Tibet, though, are so critical and so apropos for Europe, because Tibet is facing a crisis of existence because of massive Chinese immigration, which will make them a minority in their own country, which will destroy their traditions, their heritage, the control of their society.
I'm not going into the politics of Asia now, but yeah. What I would like to...
But I'm just saying is yes. That we're facing exactly the same thing with massive immigration in Europe and America and Canada and Australia and New Zealand and almost every major white nation. And it's also going to increase in Eastern Europe as well. And if this continues, we're going to be wiped away the same as Tibet is being wiped away.
Why is it that our politicians and our churches are not the spokesmen of our whispering genes?
Well, there's a lot of reasons for it. I think there's a lot of major reasons. I think the major single factor is the control of the media. And the media controls the debate, and it controls the tenor of the debate. And even the issue, like immigration. Immigration is never really presented to the American people or the people of Holland or the people of Belgium or the
all
people
of Europe.
It's not presented as a crisis of existence issue. It's not presented as something that's a crisis, that it's something that's going to determine whether our people are free, whether they even exist in the future. And so I think the media tenor, and also the fact that they can so use so much pressure and so much power to bear against those who would dare to stand up, just like the parties that got outlawed in Holland.
I did read this nice image in your book about the ship, the Titanic, that is then capsizing, parts of society will even be raised, some elite will even profit from this sudden immigration. We do a lot of organizations in Europe that profit from it. And then all of a sudden, the people on board don't realize what's going on.
Yeah.
Huh? There is a leakage under the sea.
That's correct.
Water level, which in your, in the case of the Netherlands, for instance, I've been working in parliament in a system to fight against the new Dutch law of Dutch citizenship that is giving away our passports all over the world. That something like that happened in the United States as well. Because I remember even the word melting pot comes from Mr. Zangwill.
Yeah, Zangwill, who was a Zionist, an advocate of Zionism,
exactly.
Which was the colonization of Palestine exclusively by Jews and the creation of a Jewish state.
But
he was in favor of a melting pot for America. How hypocritical. Yeah.
But even your people have been warned so many times over. There was a Mr. Leavitt. He was worrying already in 1924 that you should not have so much people coming and to immigrate in so much masses that they will not be able to assimilate and adapt to the rules of your country earlier than that they will procreate.
Well, here's how it worked. The Jewish extremists that we've talked about, these extreme racists who supported Zionism, they had a very powerful team effort. They had a lot of money, for instance, the banking houses like...
Well, we know them in Holland as well, the mayor of Amsterdam, the Mongolians.
They had a lot of power in media, and they had a lot of power, and they worked as a team. And they just methodically, almost like an army, just overcame different sectors of society.
Universities.
Exactly. Like a good example is Franz Boas. You see, the Western world, Europe and America, was moving toward a more of a racial consciousness in the 1920s. Anthropology was called a racial science. It was a study of the races of mankind, the development of mankind, the differences of mankind, which do exist, which can be measured.
Yeah. Seelenkunde.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
And all these things were progressing. In many European countries, as well as most American states, were adopting even eugenic laws. The idea that we want children to be born healthy, encourage the healthy, encourage people who are intelligent to have more children, you know, that type of thing. And discourage the placement of infirmities in our children.
But
all this was going on. The point is, all this was going on positively. But during the 1920s, also we had the rise of the Jewish power in the press. For instance, the most influential paper in the world, I think today, is the New York Times, and a Jewish family took it over. And this continued to go on. Then you had people like Boas, who started the idea of cultural anthropology, that there were no differences in races, that all the races were exactly the same. And he was, when he wrote his books, and his students like Melville Hershkovitz, Ashley Montague, whose real name was Israel Ehrenberg, Gene Welfish, Theodosius Dobansky, I can go on and on. Immediately the media where they had this influence, touted all these books, though this is the truth.
And they still do.
The new science, yes, exactly.
Also, this debate has been, within science, has been already finished 50 years ago in a way.
It's important that we make a distinction here between the word racist and somebody simply racial realist. Racist is defined as somebody who hates other races or wants to oppress them or hurt them or harm them, commit genocide against them or damage them in some way. That's what racism is defined as. It is not racism to simply understand the realities of race. The fact that there are differences among mankind, that they have different expressions of culture, different expressions of heritage, different expressions of aesthetic beauty, and that there's factors when racial conflict comes into fore, and that racial conflict is a serious problem. In fact, most of the wars we've had on Earth over the last 40 years, 50 years, have been racially born wars or ethnic wars, ethnic and religious wars, but ethnic conflict has been the primary conflict of wars. Look at the Balkans, for instance, today. Look at the Palestinian and the Jewish question. We can go on and on. Look at the different tribal wars that have existed in Rwanda, for the perfect example, or the Sudan, what's going on there. So this has been a factor. To not understand race and to recognize the realities of race is to deny the realities of mankind and really the fullness of mankind. And programs that end up damaging races and damaging society.
If you don't know anything,
so we are racially aware. We have racial understanding, but we're not racist because we don't hate others and we're not trying
but
to.
But here I have a critical question.
Yes,
a critical question.
Yes.
You see, it is because I thought, maybe here there in America with these black people, it's easy to see many differences. I have problems the same as you with the blacks, with Moroccan people, the crime rates, the hatred against us, and so on. I didn't know, is that now, blown in by religion, by radicalism? Is that really a question of race? I don't know, we don't have figures. And then I thought, but what do we know, in fact? We just have discovered this human genome, So the our genetic experts are just beginning to discover the mechanism of genetics and all that stuff. It's very dangerous, I think, for us, for a political and ethical aesthetic movement to found yourself on the science that, as we now know, each decade will have another fashion in mind.
There's no fashion about racial understanding, because race exists. It's as real as whether it rains or whether it's sunny outside. Racial differences exist. They're profound. They're not a social construct. Now, a Jewish scientist like Jared Diamond, who's one of the people who says that race is simply a social construct and not real, he's the same guy that in Smithsonian Institute magazine wrote that the DNA studies and the genome study is wonderful because now it shows it's going to be good for Israel because now Israel can find out he's really a Jew. So the same man who says there's no differences between a white person and a black person, distinct differences, is the same guy that says, well, there's actually enough differences to tell who's a Jew and a non-Jew for Israel. Yes, and so, you know, race is real. And it doesn't mean, again, we have to hate, but it means that we should understand the realities, and that we also understand, see, what you talked about the Titanic and my analogy there. People in Europe have to understand something. The trend that's going on now will become essentially an irreversible trend, unless there's dramatic change.
Demography,
because there's two factors. Not only is the immigration heavy, as they get higher numbers, they have more political power and influence, which is in turn blocking legislation to stop the flow. At the same time, the birth rate differential is dramatic, obviously, in Europe and America. The non-European immigrants that are coming in have a much higher birth rate, and their children have higher birth rates. So this continues to go on, while Europeans have a very low birth rate. And as the conditions get less, because Europeans are very conscious about the quality of life of their children, as their economics are squeezed by this massive cost of immigration, and immigration is a huge cost, as crime increases, as they're concerned about the quality of the schools for their children, they think, well, maybe I should just have one child, not three children, or because maybe I'll have enough money to send my child to a private school, or maybe I'll have enough money to escape and move some other place out of the city.
Socioeconomic factors.
Exactly. So all these factors. And so when you look at figures, like Bill Clinton was in America at a university, and he announced to the students, very proudly, he said that by the middle of this century, whites would be a minority in America. We were 90% of American thinking, but we'd be a minority, and the students applauded. I mean, our people have been taught to applaud, to cheer their own destruction, their own demise.
We will be only 10% of the world population.
Well, not only that, we will eventually, in a very short period after that, if we can go from 90% to less than 50%, Europe can go from 95% to less than 50% in 50 or 60 years. What happens in the next 50 or 60 years, an acceleration, that means we in Europe will be 10%. In the next 50 years, because the acceleration continues. As more and more water fills into the holes of the Titanic, the ship goes down faster and faster and faster until it becomes a rush. And that's what we're facing in Europe.
Okay, at least. We have now a description of the problem.
Okay.
And no one of us has, I think, all the concrete solutions. But we can now a little bit think about it, a little bit discuss it.
All right.
Now you, as far as I could read, is trying to find them also a little bit in so-called Christian values. And some of them I don't understand in this respect. I'm from Holland, I warn you, it's a liberal country, right. I might have ideas that you abhor.
That's no problem.
First, you are, I don't know whether you are yourself, but many Americans, they are against abortion. And then I think we have a problem because most women in the world now live up to menopause. That means that selection by survival has been replaced by selection by fertility, which is disastrous for the quality result of the genes. Mm-hmm. And so we have, in fact, a quantity control problem. If we now in the third world, where most people have not even been in touch with civilization or what, and where the only defense of the poor people against lower IQ or whatever is abortion, why then should we then from the West dissuade them to practice
I don't think we should dissuade them. I don't think we should be involved in the rest of the world. All right, that's the first point. And I think they can practice whatever they want to around the world, whether it be in the Arabian countries or in African, lower African countries or in China or whatever. I don't think it's our business to tell them how to conduct themselves or even how to conduct themselves morally.
But
among their own
people. You are in America, but
now,
you live here.
I live here. And in the United States of America and in Europe, abortion has been a very major factor in lowering our birth rates.
But also of the black people, or not?
Not really, because overwhelmingly the population of Europe is white, and the overwhelming 90% of the population of America was white. And the real population change does come somewhat from their birth rates, but they're not going to, like the Muslims coming in, they're not going to practice abortion anyway. The people that are practicing abortion are primarily the whites. So abortion has become very dysgenic and very as a force against white people. So maybe you're seeing a little bit about the value there. So we're the ones practicing abortion. It's been dramatic in terms of lowering birth rate. And by the way, if the European population was larger and we had more children, there would have been not any impetus for immigration. Because one way, and this is another aspect, the more deeper aspect of the problem, this not on the surface, but it's underneath. There's no question in my mind that feminism, radical feminism, has been destructive of our race in the same way that immigration has in the other ways. I think because, it was led by radical Jewish extremists, by the way, too. Because what they did was they told the European people and the American people that we were overpopulated, we had to take birth control, and that women had to go into the workplace. In fact, we changed the economics where many women were able to stay home and raise children.
Yeah. They did.
They had to go now into the workplace.
And often they work for one mortgage.
I'm not against the woman working if she chooses. But most jobs aren't glamorous and aren't wonderful.
If you are worried about the death of birds, and you now focus on abortion or.
It's all part of the problem.
Why are you not advocating polygamy? I mean, any animal breeder would advise you that.
Well, I don't think there's any sort of moral or natural prohibition of polygamy, of having many wives or whatever. I don't think that's, in fact, in history it's happened in many, many cases throughout the world. I think a moral position, though, is to have a new. I think nuclear families are healthy. I think they're evolutionary, and I think that there's been many studies that show that the children that come with nuclear families tend to be more adjusted and more productive and less dysfunctional.
Yeah, what
in society.
I would like to.
I'm not against necessarily polygamy. It's not a big question to me.
It is a little bit of a tricky question,
But I am for marriage. And I am for that principle, and I'm for the nuclear family, and I'm for things that help keep a family together. And if maybe marriage doesn't do that anymore, but if that is shown to help keep families together in a unit, I think that's good. I think that's positive.
Yeah, I'd only like to warn to say that our fight for the subsistence of our peoples should not be too much narrowed to one way of culture anywhere. There are more ways to go to it.
I agree.
Maybe some cultures have extended families to do it or whatever. Yeah, all right.
I agree with you, 100%. Right. Look, what you're saying here, I'll put it in the way I would interpret it. What you're saying to me, and what I would say in response is, yes, at this point, there is nothing more important than the survival of our people, and anything that increases our birth rate and helps our people become strong, healthy, intelligent, and more powerful, more understanding, more conscious. And that's part of what being a human being is, too. It's a level of consciousness. And our people are being taught to be unconscious, to not be conscious of even their own existence. In fact, that's what they always say, the distinction between an animal and a man is that when a man's able to be conscious of himself, whereas an animal is not conscious of himself. And that's a whole different ball of wax. And we as people, as what we call the white race, the European mankind, we've got to be conscious of what we.
Yeah, but there is a biologist, Mr. Dawkins, in your country. He says
Dawkins is from Britain.
No, not Britain. Jurisdictions.
That's a little different than
he says we are just a vehicle of our genes, and so let our genes whisper and the strongest one will come out. And then there are, of course, some Christian values which I know are very important. For instance, this fashion of in vitro
fertilization
babies. After you have screened fetuses on dysgenic diseases, it's dangerous because you will maybe prevent some dysgenic babies with diseases to be born, but you don't kill, in a way, the carrier. So there is some, and I tell this because there is a Russian publisher, Mr. Glad, about eugenics, and he does do that in a very nice quarterly, the Occidental Quarterly, maybe you know that.
I know very well.
And
my good friend Roger Pearson is the editor.
Yeah,
of the
I see. Now, and he is telling us that eugenics can do very well for the whole of humanity, knowing that good genes are scattered anywhere or among all groups, but that unfortunately Christianity and creationism, I know you are not a creationist, but some of these tendencies vilify, in effect, these efforts to improve humanity by eugenics, if we are able to, in the long run, no one knows, not only to take away diseases,
right.
Up till now no scientist has the courage to link genes with behavior, for instance, but maybe in the long run we all can prosper. He says we should also, but we should not link, say, inter-ethnic group fightings with eugenics, otherwise there will be ill will to practice it. But in the long run, I think this
I agree with you 100%. I mean, there's nothing you said. I think eugenics offers man the greatest opportunity for advancement. And it's far greater than any sort of scientific or technological advancement. This is all throughout history, throughout mankind's history. Man's always been concerned about the quality of his tools or the ability of making a better tool, a better way to plow a field, or a better way to see the stars and to steer a boat, or a better way to build a building, architecture, or make better music. And for the first time, we really understand now that the real source of it all is the quality of ourselves.
So what
if we have good, high genetic quality, we will make whatever tools we need. We will make the greatest aspects of art and literature and music. So there's nothing more important than the quality of mankind himself. So I'm in favor of programs and policies that improve our kind. I also believe, of course, we must do this with a sense of morality. I don't believe a state should be there and say, you must marry you, or you must do this. But it makes sense, for instance, to the highest intelligent and most capable people to go to the same schools and have that school oriented toward their abilities, and they naturally tend to marry. I would be in favor of bringing people out, no matter what their income is, if they have abilities, to go to the best schools on the basis of their ability.
I have two critical questions.
Sure.
Here. I'd like to know from you whether you are for this, say, universal eugenics, say, all mankind should be able to profit from scientific results, or is there in your mind a tipping point where you say, even if genes within my own group, so to speak, are not at the top level, maybe the Chinese people have or what, I rather prefer to keep being my own group, or is it, no, that is genetic provincialism, and we will strive for the improvement of the entire planet?
That's excellent questions, and this is how I would answer it. And by the way, I've never been asked those kinds of deep questions before in an interview. I've been interviewed thousands of times, and so I must commend you in the fact that you're asking deep questions, and I hope all your viewers understand that the fact that this is a better level interview than you're going to get in most media. But here's my answer to that. First off, I think eugenics has to be available for all races and all peoples. That what we believe in eugenics will benefit Africans, it will benefit Asians, it will benefit Mongolians, Japanese, it will benefit white people, it will benefit Mexicans, all people. I do think also as well that genetics and evolution takes place in certain gene pools. And science will show that. That's the mechanism of evolution. It's not just individuals, but groups. And there's certain there's things called genetic dissonance and genetic congruity. And
drift.
Yes, and the rest. And there's no question in my mind that evolutionary progress is made when you have a more distinct and you have a more homogeneous population. Then you're able to take in certain genetic elements that are positive and utilize them.
So by, say, genetic drift or environmental tensions or this will go into the direction of a certain genetic pool in some groups, and then you can take over.
That's our progress. For instance, let me example to make a very crude example in the farmyard. In the farmyard, scientists make certain strains of crops that produce more fruit, or certain animals to have certain more stamina, more abilities, or more resistant to disease, whatever. But they do that by very controlled by breeding within a certain group. If they just throw all those into a big group, they lose the qualities that they create. And evolution, race is a creation of evolution. Race is a creation of geographic separation over great periods of time. That's why we exist the way we do. It's a creation of separation. And when you just try to mix the races together, what you're simply doing is you're just like throwing everything into a soup pot. You might not have a very good result.
No.
Might not be edible.
I would like to take the opportunity now to some listeners, maybe of the press as well, and ask them, demand them, to go themselves into newest discoveries of genetics. If it's too difficult for you, as well as it is for us, you can read the book as Nature via Nurture, knowing that genes can also be carrier of experience and so on. So the debate is not anymore nature or nurture or heredity or environment, whatever. This should be the debate. We know now that we have not been born tabula rasa with an empty slate. We have this wisdom in us. Different wisdoms at different parts of the world, and we are here today to say you should not all have them killed by admixture, but see to the special qualities and maybe exchange. So this has nothing to do with these outdated ideas of racism and so on. That is only the press is telling you that, because they don't read science for the last 20 years, I guess.
Well, another good example of that is, and we've got to keep the scientific information going, even among our own movement. There's a whole science now called epigenetics. And epigenetics shows that you're affected by your genes. You're also affected by how you live. And how you live, what you eat, can even affect your children and your grandchildren.
Exactly.
Susceptible to disease. So the way you conduct yourself, if you let yourself, for instance, get overly fat and healthy, you can actually affect the genes and how the genes turn on in your children and your grandchildren. They can pay a price for your lack of responsibility. This whole movement, I believe, around the world, the movement of European rights and heritage, it's not about hurting anybody else, and it's not hypocritical. It's not like the Jewish extremists. We're not pushing one thing for our people and something entirely different for everybody else. What we want for our people, the preservation of our heritage, our culture, our way of life, our values, and the best qualities in us, we want that for every race, that they have the ability to pursue their own heritage and have their own freedom in their own homelands. That's what all we're talking about here. And we also know that we are teaching among our own people that you've got to be responsible. In fact, the way you do in your life right now, whether or not you abuse alcohol or whether you do drugs, and that's another factor, people who do drugs can actually carry certain traits into their children, will affect not only you, but your children's and their children's children. You have a tremendous responsibility, and when Europeans finally realize they have an absolute responsibility to themselves, their families, to their culture, to their whole group, their whole race, and to their homelands, then we will perhaps have the courage and the energy and the passion to do what we must do to preserve ourselves.
I come to my last section of this interview.
Yeah.
That's politics, because we have now the problem. We know a little bit, we will see what science can bring us or not. But we know now that what some people call visceral policies, in Dutch it's called onderbuikgevoelens, feelings of the belly,
yes,
which is a pejorative notion. Some people call it populism.
Yes.
Is in fact the voice of our whispering genes,
yes,
asking for a way to express themselves.
Yes.
And we have been forced upon by the press and the Zionist theoreticians, which we mentioned,
yeah,
to base our genetic drift on some scientific data, but the billion of Chinese people,
yeah,
or the billion of Hindu people, or whatever, they never had that problem.
They don't.
In China, they never believed we come from Africa, so they invented the Peking man. I mean, there is only we have this discussion why we are so masochistic about it. Why don't we say in reciprocity, oh, come on, how is that with you? Where is your scientific foundation for your crowd? That's strange to me. And in fact, I read some Chinese, and I can see that they think we are very weak people.
Well, the truth is, as you know by now, I think most people in the world, the scientific community, knows now that Europeans actually went all the way across Asia, including into China. Europeans actually brought the wheel to China, the domesticated horse to China, the woven cloth to China.
Well, they also invented something of themselves.
Well, they certainly did, and I'm not saying they didn't, but what I'm saying is we have a tremendous anti-European value system, and even in the Americas, we hear a lot about the Indian issues. We now know that Europeans, there's an article today in the, I think, in the Telegraph of Great Britain, in the science editor, saying that there's now clear evidence, they know genetic evidence, mitochondrial evidence, that Europeans have been in the Americas since 30,000 years ago. That pushes it back another 12,000
years. But
we are giving a guilt complex for the so-called genocide of the Indians in the Americas. There's no guilt complex for the Indians of the genocide of Europeans. And we have a double standard that continues
to
exist.
We should have a sense of guilt for our fratricide last century to have killed among each other.
Exactly. The fact that we've had these fratricidal wars have been very destructive of us, and you're absolutely correct.
So to talk about say Western white supremacy, why we have been killing each other
every race,
so much.
Every race and every group has at some time or other invaded other people's lands.
Exactly.
And there's no unique guilt to the white race. Let me tell you something, there is a lot of unique credit you can give the white race. The whole world enjoys so much of the white culture, art, literature, music, human rights values, and all
yeah.
the rest of it. And we should be proud of that, and our people need to develop this pride. And then one more thing, you know, the genocide that we're facing. You don't have to read much of the Holocaust information, and our society is saturated with the Holocaust, movies, films, books. You don't have to read much of that information to realize that genocide is evil, and that anyone who resists genocide is justifiable. And we Europeans have a right to resist any sort of genocide.
Even by ourselves, suicide. Genocide.
Well, if a few white Europeans get gathered together and try to kill all the white Europeans, including themselves,
yeah.
we have a right to resist it. We don't have to live like Jim Jones. Remember the minister that was in South America that killed all their people. That's genocide, and we have a right to resist genocide. We have a right to resist by any means necessary.
But you do as if that is something coming from outside, while it is in fact a kind of loss of will to subsist.
Well, I think that's true, but I think we have been basically affected by an alien pathogen. I think that we
at
have
at least in the West.
Yes, exactly.
That's why we are here. We have here this meeting of Euro-Rus.
Okay.
And that's our last remark. I ask you, what do you expect from Euro-Rus? What did the can the Russians contribute? Only their genes or their geniality?
Well, I think the Russians are a fresh addition. To Europe, with the new arrangement between Russia now and Europe, I think we can have a fresh new breeze of ideology. And the Russian state is probably the freest of the European states right now. There's more dissent.
On these topics.
Yes, on these topics. And so that could be a very positive thing. And I think what our job is to bring, here we are in Western Europe, and it's our job to bring to our people to not listen to this media propaganda about how Russia is now our enemy and anti-Russian propaganda, and make people realize these are our brothers and sisters in Russia, and that together, perhaps, and in fact we must, we can overcome these tendencies and these policies toward genocide.
Thank you very much, Stefan.
You're welcome.
En hiermee sluit ik af het programma, derde in de reeks van Europa tussen Amerikanisering en islamisering. We hebben niet zoveel gesproken over islamisering, maar dat is in Amerika denk ik een hoog topic. Hier laat ik erbij. Dank u wel.
Thank you.